for the introduction. I don't think I presented about myself actually. I don't know what I said, so exactly. But anyway, my name is Patroklos, and I'm from Greece. And that's my first time in Moscow and Russia in general. And until now, my experience has been great, amazing. Okay, so just a few words about me. So I'm a researcher at Census. We're looking at community research, research engineering, social development. And also we have a lot of food for these things. That are mostly internal. Sometimes we speak about them, sometimes we release them. Before that, I was doing like a PhD and a postdoc in clinical Dublin, where I mostly applied cryptographic stuff. And most of this work that I'm going to talk about today has been after a lot of like experience and discussions with my friend Kuku, who together we write most exploits and we do like a little vulnerability research together. But unfortunately, he put it at then because he's actually doing compulsory internship, which is still a thing to read. Okay, so that's like a warning. There are no pictures installed, no diagrams, no charts. There's almost no math, just some small stuff. And there's a lot of text. And I promise not to just read the slides, but explain. And also, that's what I'm going to talk about today. It's not like a complete like set of work, like a work in progress. And as you will see, the kind of stuff that it deals with means that it will always be a work in progress. Okay, so the outline is going to give a quick introduction about what heap exploitation means. And what is the motivation between the work? Some related work, some other people that can talk about related things. Then I'm going to quickly go through types and categories of heap bugs. Then I'm going to talk about heap attacks and how, based on these attacks, how can you abstract them and see them like in a more general way. And seeing them actually as primitives that can be used in other kind of scenarios and on other applications. And then I'm going to finish the talk with some thoughts about how we can model these primitives and how we can create a model that we can put the primitives in use that will help us understand new targets and new allocators. And maybe semi-automate the whole process. Okay, before, let me ask you, you all know what the heap is, right? Yeah, okay. So, how many of you know the different heap bugs, like heap overflows, user after threes, dangling pointers, stuff? Okay. How many of you have used like an exploit and are aware that it was like a heap exploit, like a heap buffer overflow or like a metadata corruption? Okay, how many of you have actually written a heap exploit in the last like 10 months or so? Okay. Okay, so heap bugs are the most common type of bugs. So if you look into an application, you see that it uses a lot of dynamic memory. So doesn't have like static like buffers and stuff like that, but it uses malloc or related APIs to allocate dynamic memory. So we're going to attack that allocator that the application uses, then we need to fully understand it. And that means understanding its metadata. The metadata are actually the data structures used by the allocator to manage dynamic memory. We also need to understand the algorithms that it implements, how it allocates and how it deallocates memory. We also need to understand how the application that we are targeting uses the internal allocator. When it does, for example, when we do something at the user level, what happens underneath it? Is there an allocation happening or a deallocation? And Also, we need to understand how we can put data that we control on the ship. And all of these, we need to view them in a way that we plan to put it in towards exploiting the application, right? To actually make it do something it wasn't supposed to do and break security boundary. Now, all of these are not like isolated because there aren't like a lot of low-hanging fruits anymore. So most of the bugs you're going to find are complicated bugs. Very, very infrequently you will find like standard, like memcopy, ship buffer, or whatever. And also there is an increasing push by the vendors to implement exploitation mitigations to make all of these things that I'm talking about here, that I have listed here, more difficult for you as an attacker. So that was the motivation that it's difficult to understand an allocator and actually exploit it. And as I said, the trend in the industry that this becomes increasingly more complex and more hard. So what we need to do as attackers is to find ways to reduce the time required to understand an allocator and attack it. And I want to mention that my goal is not to do an academic exercise, right? It's not like to create a mathematical model that describes one or two allocators and put it out there in the public. That's not what I want to do. What I want to do is like create practical, usable work, identify attack primitives that people that write exploits can use them, either to make their life easier when they're looking at a new target, or to actually teach this stuff to new people that are not that not have a lot of experience in this. Okay, so the traditional tool to tackle the complexity is abstraction. I mean, that's what you learn at Computer Science 101. And an example of that are the design patterns used in software engineering. So I'm sure most of you have heard of design patterns. So it's like they have identified, the software engineering industry have identified reusable solutions that they take, that other people can describe, but without thinking too much, if you understand the problem, then they give you like a reusable like solution to apply and solve the problem. So, okay, heap exploitation will be a bit more complicated than writing software, but the concept is the same, right? So we need to identify reusable solutions for heap exploitation. Okay, what I want to mention here is this. So when I'm talking about exploitation stop, I'm always going to refer to memory corruptions, right? So I'm not going to say anything about XSS or stuff like that. So you should always view it in the context of memory corruptions. A few words about other people who have tried to do some exploitation abstraction work. So I think it was in Black Hat Europe 2011, I heard Chris Valasek and Ryan Smith talk about how you attack modern applications and how they have like identified that there are techniques that can be reused and reused and reused in various usable targets. Mayhem then talked about this automated exploitation grand challenge. His goal is to identify vulnerabilities and write exploits for them with reduced human intervention. So basically he identified categories of exploit primitives, both for heap vulnerabilities and other type of vulnerabilities. And basically he models the heap as a probabilistic transition system. That means that he views it like he thinks that the heap, and he's right, there is such a pattern. So he tries to bring to light the hidden probabilistic regularity of the heap. So the heap may be non-deterministic, but it really isn't, right? There are some regular, things that happen all the time. So he tries to identify the probabilities of that. And then basically what he does is he takes he models the system and with a set of all possible random walks and the exploitable heap states, and then he finds the random walks that lead to the states that are most helpful for exploiting the information there. The word machine concept by Flake and Sergey Gragus. So basically what they're saying is that an application should be viewed like a state machine that transitions between states based on the previous state. But when a memory corruption happens, then this state machine is corrupt, right? So you are now able, after the memory corruption, to reach states that the application developer haven't thought of. And if these states lead to the violation of security boundaries, then you can achieve some kind of application. Miller has talked about that there is a finite state of primitives that allow you to transition between states after you've done a memory corruption. So, for example, a memory corruption may give you like a read primitive or a write primitive. So he then focuses on how to reuse these primitives to reach other states that are helpful for exploitation. Okay, so I'm going to quickly go over the different types of heap bugs. The buffer overflow, so you have a buffer allocated on the heap, usually through a malloc call or a new or something like that, C++. And basically, then you do like a miscalculation of the size of the memcopy, for example, and you use it as a destination of the memcopy. And basically, what you have is you have the data that you get, that put there to override what is after the buffer of the heap. And maybe it's not a memcopy call, right? It could be like a for loop where you have some kind of control of its end condition. So that's the buffer overflow. Dynamic state pointers. So this basically means that you have an allocated heap item, like an object, for example. So you have instantiate the class with new, and the object goes on the heap. And then there's a pointer to that object. Then at some point, there is an action that actually frees the object from the heap. However, the developer forgets to invalidate a previous pointer that points this object on the heap. Then we call this object, this pointer that points to the object that has been freed as a dangling or stale pointer. I have an example, sorry. Okay, so that's a diagram, like a diagram I made from when I was looking at the J-malloc allocator. So that, just to give you a quick example. So here you have regions. You can think of regions as like heap slots, right? So the heap has been divided into slots, and then they have been allocations. So all these blue things here are objects, right, on the heap. And then you have pointers to them. Then you pose an action like a JavaScript call or like some network packet, or we're talking about the server, and then some of these objects are free, but the references to them still remain with you with the bind, the developer forgetting to validate the pointers. So if you want to exploit that, basically you have to reclaim these free regions here that the reference still point. And then it depends on the bug, how you're going to exploit that. So it depends on what object was there and what object was placed there. But that's the general. Yeah. Okay, what I forgot to mention here is that obviously, when you try to reclaim a slot, what you're putting there must be the same size as the one that you speak by. all these slots here are of the same size. So, as I said, you have to reclaim that slot, right, that has been free. Depending on the bug, you may have to like spray the heap, for those that don't know the term, means that you make a lot of allocations. So you found a way to make the target application make a lot of allocations. Like, for example, if it's a network server, do a lot of requests to and keep them open and close them. Or if it's like a browser, like creating a lot of strings or something. So you claim this slot. Okay, so what I'm saying here is that depending on what was there and what you placed there, that obviously affects how you build this work. What's important here is that although and that's really the case here, it's very obvious in this diagram here. So you have freed the object from the heap and you still have a reference to it. And then, basically you were fuzzy or something like that. Right? So there isn't, you may not have a crash actually at this point because the dereference here doesn't go into unmapped memory. So these slots here may be marked as free, but they're not really unmapped because the whole page here that is divided into the slots is marked memory under the control of the algorithm. So that's important because sometimes you cannot identify things before the project. Double free, that's basically again an error by the programmer, and it's obvious in this small snippet I have here. So he makes an allocation, and then if some condition happens, he frees the allocation. But then at a later stage, he forgot that he had this condition here, and he frees it again. So if you can force this condition and then do it that other free here, you have a double free. So depending on the allocator, this may be exploitable or not. So may cause some corruption or not. So, for example, if it is a linked list allocator, like keeping the different regions in a linked list, then this probably leads to corruption of the metadata. But if it's like a bitmap-based allocator, then you don't have a corruption. A bitmap-based allocator, you think of it like you have an array, and each slot of the array represents a region of the heap. So if the bitmap has an 1, it means that the corresponding heap slot is used. If it has a 0, it means that it is free. So double freeing something just means putting a 0 2 times in the bitmap. So depending on the allocator, this will not be the corruption. Okay, so now we have seen a very quick introduction of the different heap bugs. And now we're going to talk a bit about how we attack a heap allocator. So we have our target, maybe anything like a browser, operating system kernel, doesn't matter. Internally, it has an allocator, right? So if it's like a small application, it may use the allocator provided by the system, like if you're on Linux, libc's allocator. Mm-hmm. If you're like on a big like browser, like Firefox, for example, Firefox has its own allocator, jmalloc. If you're talking about an operating system kernel, then almost definitely it's like its own memory. So I'm going to go, so assuming we have a new target that we haven't looked at before, how we go about attacking the allocator. So the first step that I always do is try to identify how I can influence the allocator that is internal to my target. So remember that we are the attacker, right? So we are outside of this target of us. We don't have direct access to the allocator's API. We can only cause allocations and the allocations indirectly. So I have some examples of that here. So if we're talking about an operating system kernel, that's a system call, right? So if you issue a system call, then maybe some memory allocation happens. Or an IOCTL, or opening, closing devices. Or maybe the operating system is a driver loaded that exposes an API to user line. And through this API, you can cause allocations. If we're talking about the browser, then it's usually JavaScript, or basically we're talking about Internet Explorer. Or if it has a Flask plugin, you can influence its allocator to action script. The situation is a bit more complex when we're talking about applications that pass files. So for example, if we're targeting VLC, how do you influence the allocation and the allocation patterns of VLC? So you start playing with a specific format you know. So for example, you take MP4 and you see that it has like atoms and various different tags. You start playing with the tags and see how these affect the allocations. So you need a way to enumerate the different interfaces to the allocator. As I said, these are not direct interfaces, these are direct interfaces. So one of the most common ways is like open your target application with a debugger, place like specific breakpoints to the functions you have identified that do the allocations, and then you keep your breakpoints output data like the size of the allocation, the term address of the allocation, or the address to be free if it's a breakpoint on a free function. And you can also take the backtrace of the allocation, which is very helpful, because if you have symbols, it may help you understand which actions that you took on the outer layer have caused this allocation to happen in the allocator level. Now, this is a lot of manual work, and if you're trying to like automate it, it may be slow and error prone. So it's a useful tool, but you also need to find some other way to automate it in a better way. So you can use dynamic binary implementation frameworks like Pin or Dynamorio. So I don't know if you know this is a good tool. So basically what they allow you to do is do binary instrumentation. So you take your target and you're saying that while it runs, if it does like a malloc call, I want this to happen. And you write code to do something when that malloc happens. So it gives you an API to launch the application, to put like conditions when something happens. And you don't need the source code for that, right? The binary instrumentation frameworks. There are a lot of examples out there for you to play with, both for Pin and Dynamorio. Both of them have this image page filtering, which is very, very helpful for real targets. So for example, if you have Explorer as your target, or Firefox, or any other like big application, you see that it loads a lot of DLLs. So usually, you don't target like a complete browser, but target like a small part of it that is implemented by a specific DLL. So you need to trace the allocations and the freeze only that specific DLL, so that basically. Now the problems with Pin and Dynamorio is that they're only for user environments, so there isn't like a binary instrumentation framework for the kernel. There is like Kpro, like for system data for the Linux kernel, and Dtrace for the OSX kernel. But when you go to the embedded like world, there aren't so many choices there. Now, another way we have used in the past to do that on a kernel level is with the dynamic kernel module. So we write a module that overrides the malloc and the free of the kernel. And when this call happens, it prints some data like the size of the allocation, its internal address, things like that. We also do manual stack unwinding if we have symbols that let us create filters. So as you can expect, if you hook like kernel's malloc, you get a lot of output. So you need some way to focus on specific things that you know interest you. Like for example, what happens when you're opening a specific device. So you want to see only the malloc calls that happens when you open a specific device. So basically, you need a way to filter the unrelated malloc. So the way we did it was by one second winding the program. Then we, these things that I talked about were like a dynamic way to do the interface mapping of the algorithm. You can also do it statically, and that gives you a lot of information. So you have the source code of the application you're targeting, or if you don't have the source code, you have the disassembly in a disassembly like IDA, right? So no, okay. What I want to say here is that you have the source code, or it's a binary application for which you have symbols. So now you have a way to find which objects and which stack of the application are of what size. And this is really helpful to know, because as we have seen, sometimes when you're doing an attack, you have to know what choices you have to put in a specific size slot. So you can either like parse the source code and get the sizes of the different structures, and if you don't have like a source code, you use like binding symbols like PPPs on Windows or Dwarf on Linux and OSX, and try to get this information from there, like the sizes of the objects, the classes, and the size of the structure. So on Microsoft platforms, you can parse PPP files with the DIA, the back interface access DLL, that exposes an API, it's kind of investigating the message on the PPP. For Linux and Dwarf, there are like a lot of tools that can do that. For Mako and Dwarf, these .dsim files, I don't know if you've seen them, that have debugging information for Mako binaries, there aren't so many choices. So one of the things we have found that works is this LLPB utility publication API that comes with LLPB, exposes a Python interface, and allows you to get debug information from these single files. Okay, so now you have like a list of classes supported by your target, what size objects they create when they're allocated on the heap, and the same for structures. So you have a list of the structures, and when they're instanced, what size they are. So the next step is to find how to cause an allocation of the specific object you are interested in. So one way to do that is with standard like static analysis techniques. So if we're talking like about a media player, you're basically trying to find call paths, static, right? So from media, let's say, call paths from like a function that parses the metadata types of the media file to the actual allocation of the class that scrapes this metadata in memory when the object is transient. If you have source code, you can do that with C-Lang tools. Like I have found that the C-Lang Python bindings are not very rich in the API. It don't give you a lot of functionality to play with, but the libpooling C-Lang library and the C-Lang plugins, they give you everything you need to do this kind of thing. Of course, in the need of Python, if we're talking about closed-source application, I have to say that the way we do that, my team is that we don't do like any kind of fancy like path-sensitive analysis, right? So when we find the path, we don't actually check the different conditions of the path to see that how we can actually reach the allocation. So we basically use it like as a roadmap, like not like specific actual hard information that is true. That's the path that allows us to play at the higher layer of those allocations at the low level, at the allocator level. It's fast, but 50%. So we don't really have any flexibility of performance. So, to summarize what we have said so far, so we're targeting your new application that you haven't seen before, which is another paper that you haven't dealt with in the past. So you try to find how you can cause allocations, how you can cause freeze, how you can cause allocations of specific sizes, and furthermore, how you can cause allocations of a specific like object or structure. So that's the primitives you have identified so far. One interesting thing here that I want to mention is this new mitigation in the latest Internet Explorer called Protected Tree. So basically, this if we see it in this context that I'm talking about today, what this new mitigation does is breaks primitive number two. So primitive number two was the free, right? So the control free, so whichever way, caused the application to free memory. So we do something at the layer of control, like with a JavaScript call, or like with a system call, we're talking about an external kernel, or like with a metadata in a media player file. And this makes an IP allocation happen, a free happen. So basically, this protected free mitigation, what it does is that when you try to free an object, it doesn't actually free, but it puts it on a list to be freed later. So at some point in the future, and if certain conditions happen, so for example, if there are like I think more than 100,000 k on that list, then it goes and frees them. So it basically it breaks the determinism of the free primitive. So you cannot directly control when the free will happen. And the other interesting thing here is that if you look like generally to the different mitigations that the vendors have been introducing for the past years, you will see that all of them more or less try to break the determinism of what an attacker exploits. So as an attacker, you want to create something with a good like probability. So that means that you're exploiting the determinism of whatever it is that you target. So the mitigations, what they do, they usually break this determinism. And this is a great example. Okay, so the next primitive that I want to talk about is heap arrangement. So let's say that you have like an overflow on the heap. That means that you're basically overflowing from a buffer on the heap to something else that is after that. So you need to arrange the heap in such a way that when you overflow from it to something else, something useful is going to happen for you. So basically what you need to do is you need to bring the heap to a predictable state. So this has been called as heap feng shui by Sotirov for web browsers. And basically, to be able to do that, you need to understand the allocator's behavior. So you observe it while it runs. You see, for example, if it is FIFO or LIFO. So FIFO means that when you free an item and then you, at some other point you cause an allocation, that means that the allocator turns you the first free item. The first keep item that goes free. LIFO means that it gives you the last one. So you observe this either through while your target is running or by reversing its function to do allocation and deallocation. Okay, so you're attacking an application, right? So let's say it's a browser or an operating system. So when you start your attack, you don't know what you don't know the state of the target's heap is at. You have no way of knowing. So you need to use your interface primitive that you have identified in the previous step to bring the allocator in a predictable state. So some examples of that is do a lot like of the same size type allocations, and what you're trying to do is to defrag the heap. And when you do new allocations after that, you give you like a fresh like slot container as page. That means that all your other allocations after that point will be continuous, will be one after the other on the heap. So once you have this, you can go and free every other allocation, so you create like pods. Okay, so that's an example of this kind of heap arrangement on the J-malloc allocator. So you have these containers for heap items or slots, right? It's here. And basically what you did at this first step is to do a lot of allocations of a specific object that you know has something interesting, like function control. And then at the second step, you go and free every other one. And so you have this kind of pattern now. Used, free, used, free, used, free. And then at the final step, you go and trigger your bug, your heap bug. So that means that the vulnerable buffer is going to be placed at a free slot here, and then the overflow is going to happen because you have triggered your bug. So you're going to overflow into a used object. And as I said, this object would be like an object that has function pointers. So now you have a function pointer with data that you control. So that's an example of this attack on the J-malloc allocator. I have another example here. this is the slug allocator that is in the Linux kernel. So at the first step here, you have no idea what state the heap is in, the kernel heap is in. So you go and do a lot of allocations, right? So now you have, the allocator has given you like a free page. And let's say by chance there is a visual here, that's an example, all of them free. The thing is that you have made a lot of this allocation. Now, the good thing about Linux is that it has like a proc interface, so proc is like a pseudo file system that gives you information about the kernel while the kernel is running. So you can actually ask through the proc interface the specific like let's say container you're targeting for the specific size, how many items he has free, how many he has used. So at this point here, you know how many allocations to make. And so now you have so you can make this, so the allocator has now given you a fresh page, right, with three slots. So you go and you do allocations of like a vulnerable object you've identified, like, sorry, not a vulnerable object, an object that you've identified is something useful, like a function pointer. So you make some allocations of that, but not like, you're not now trying to cover all the three slots, but just some of them. And then at the next step, so you get this pattern, right? So use, free, use, use. So you have at least one, three, hopefully, if you haven't made a lot of them. And you know exactly how many to make, because proc can tell you that. And then you go at the last step and you make your heap, you trigger your heap buffer overflow. So now you get this free slot and you overflow from it to a used slot that is like an interesting object, like an object part. Of course, I mean, whether this kind of heap arrangement works or not for the target allocator is something that we need to study, right? So these are good techniques to know, and when you're investigating a new target, you try to recreate them. It doesn't mean that it will always work, but something similar will work. Let's summarize the new primitive you have seen. It's the force continuous allocation, so you need to be able to make allocations that are one after the other. You need a way to make holes between them. And you need a way, of course, to reclaim the free slot. So this reclamation of the free slot, you have studied the allocator, you have seen, like, for example, a system call creates a specific allocation of a specific like structure that goes to the specific size and slope of the flood itself. Now, the other mitigation that is included in the latest Internet Explorer breaks this seventh trilogy here. So what they have done is that they have identified classes that are most frequently used by attackers, based on like previous exploits and on their own knowledge of Internet Explorer internals. So they have said that these classes are dangerous. So we're not going to place the allocations of these classes on the general heap that all the other classes go to, but we're going to create a different heap for those. And they call that the isolated heap. So this basically breaks the seventh grid. Yeah, so it breaks your, so you have like done your strain, so you can now the contiguous allocations, you can read some of them, and now you want to reclaim the spot, but you cannot. Because you cannot like place one of these dangers of this object that have something interesting like a function pointer on this slot, it goes somewhere else. Of course, this isn't like real type safety, right? So real type safety means that for an allocator means that you cannot reuse a slot of a specific object with another object. That's not like that. It's not real type safety. It is what the name says. It's an isolated heap. So some of objects go there and all the others go somewhere else. Of course, from this, if you look a lot into the Internet Explorer and said internals, maybe you will find some other object that does not go on the isolated Internet games. But this mitigation is trying to make it hard. So now let's go to the next set of preview. The next set of preview is the metadata attacks. So by metadata means the data that the allocator uses to manage itself, manage the memory it keeps. So basically what you want to do with the other primitives we've talked about up to this point. What you want to do is you want to place free slots that you're going to reclaim with like a heap buffer overflow next to metadata of the allocator. So if you corrupt an allocator's metadata, that means that you control or somehow control up to a certain point the allocator's behavior. So what do you do next? Of course, these are highly specific to your allocator, right? So you need to start the allocator, you need to see what metadata it uses, you need to see if these are somewhere near like the user data, like when you do like something that you interface with allocator, it goes, if there is like possibility of overflowing into them, things like that. The truth is that most allocators out there follow similar designs. So the experience has shown that different allocators for like completely different like things behave the same way, and you can reduce this kind of attacks. And I have an example here. So in 2000, there was this explanation of the Alink attack by Solar Designer. So basically, this was on an old glibc. Now there are mitigations for that. They check the pointers here. But the general idea is that you have a controlled overflow on the metadata of the allocator. So now you control these values here. So basically, you control the what and the where. So when it does the actual unlinking from the linked list, you have a write what, where primitive. So that's like the canonical metadata attack, example. Now, the interesting thing about that, and what I mentioned earlier, is that techniques can be used and reused and reused, is that the exact same attack was applicable on the Windows kernel. And it was applicable up until Windows Vista, I think. I think they implemented similar mitigations to glibc in Windows 7. So that's a great example, because it shows you that once you understand like some attacks for a specific target, you can abstract, take the essence of the attack and reuse it on another target. Some other primitive that doesn't, metadata attack primitive that doesn't apply to linked list allocators is the one we should call that in the context of the J malloc allocator we've been studying, the forced return user allocator. Let me explain what this is. J malloc is an allocator that is not linked list based. So it has arrays, bitmaps, that represent the different slots on the heap. So you have the elements of this bitmap representing if the corresponding heap slot is empty or free. So they have a value 1 for a free slot and a value 0 for a user. So if we corrupt the metadata of the allocator, we can corrupt the index that shows if the index on the bitmap that shows if the target the slot is used or not. So basically, corrupting this index, this metadata variable that is used as an index to the bitmap, the allocator uses that to find the first free slot. Like so it goes to the array, it walks through the array, and when it sees like a free slot, it returns to the corresponding slot. But if you corrupt this index, you can force the allocator to return you an already used slot. Right? So you make the allocator, instead of returning you like a free slot, to return to you a slot that it's already using for something. So if the allocator does that, then you can go right there, whatever, and trigger the application to your target to use the slot, and things will happen. Another attack that it is I like very much, and it's actually still very valid, because we passed, is the House of Force. Now, this, exactly, I think it was 2004, I think, something like that. There was this backtrack post about ways to attack the glibc allocator, the glibc malloc implementation. This was like a very detailed explanation, but it was just textual explanation. There were no snippets of code or things like that. It was great work. And a lot of people after that started studying it and writing other papers that explained it in more detail and with specific examples. The vendors, I mean, the guys that maintained GLibc, have started gradually to, after they have seen a real attack against the allocator that used this technique from AlloCalificare, to actually patch GLibc. So I think at this point all of them have been patched except House of Force. So the general idea is that you by corrupting the metadata of the allocator, you force it to return you an arbitrary address. so that's really useful because you can make like return like a PLT or something like that, and override the function that's going to go. I will go quickly and how this can happen, but it's very specific to GLibc. The general idea is that the GLibc malloc implementation, there's like a top chunk that represents the whole heap. This is of a specific size though, right? A specific small size that is decided when the allocator is instantiated. When you make a request to the allocator, it goes and checks the size that it requested with the size that is specified in the top chunk. So if the size you have requested is smaller than the size of the top chunk, then the top chunk is split in two. It gives you the size that you want, the split part that satisfies your request, and then the other split part becomes the top chunk, the new top chunk. But if it is bigger, then it grows the top chunk, and then again splits it. So basically, if you have a way to corrupt the size that specifies in the top chunk, then what you can do is make this size very big, and when you go and request a new size, you make it very big, and this size influences the address that's going to return. But since you have corrupted the size, the check that does see if it is smaller doesn't work, so it gives you like an arbitrary address that you control through the size of the allocation request. And as I said, you can calculate exactly the address that you're going to return to you, so you can choose whatever you want over there. Okay, so let's try to extract the primitives of this. We have the unlinked primitive that's applicable to linked list allocators. We have the force return used, which basically you force the allocator to return to you a slot that is already used. And then we have the force return arbitrary, to force the allocator to return an arbitrary address as the actual, as the free slot that it's, that's actually an arbitrary address. Now, the next way to attack an allocator is the adjacent region attack. So, through these mitigations that have been introduced and are always introduced, basically you lose some of the capabilities or algorithm to attack the metadata of the allocator. So now you have to go and see the actual application that you're targeting, if it has like interesting things that can be already in. So I think I have explained that in previous slides, but the idea is you make your application and make like an allocation of an internal object that it uses, and then you try to overflow on it. These are the adjacent region attacks. So it's something like that. So these regions are adjacent and go from the other one. This slide basically says what I was talking about. Now, when you're searching through the target application, trying to identify classes or structures that have interesting things in it, the canonical like ways to try to find function pointers, but this is not only the interesting thing, it could be X, right? It could be anything. Like for example, it could be like an array object. So if you overflow its size field, the index to the array, you can place it wherever you want. Or a vector or something like that. Like for example the attacks you have seen on the flash plugins, memory allocator that play with this thing. They corrupt the size of the vector object to get arbitrarily dry. Now the interesting thing about this is that page heap, if your target is Windows, can help a lot with that. So let's say you have identified your target object. Okay, I have a lot of things to talk about, but I'll go through them very quickly. So the general idea here is that you place something interesting on the heap and then you overflow on it. You need to find this interesting thing by looking through your target. I will go very quickly through this. Now we have our primitives, right? So we need a way to semi-automate this, like to use these primitives, find a way to automate all these things that I talked about, how to find the interesting things about the application, how to find the indirect APIs that allow you to do allocations and freeze. So the first step when you try to do any kind of automation is model what you're trying to automate. But there is like a trap there. So if you model like a specific allocator, then how do you know that this model applies to another allocator? Most probably you know. So does that really make any, does it have any practical use? The simple way to think about like the most simplistic model you can think about is model the whole heap as an array. So your heap slots are the array elements, and heap reads are array accesses, and heap writes are array updates, like put some value, a specific array slot. Then how do you model the metadata? So basically you need, after we have thought about that a lot, we decided that the way to do this is to have like a different array representing each metadata there on Polder, which is not very realistic. I mean, it quickly becomes very complicated. So the new way we're thinking about this is with the deterministic automata. Since I don't have a lot of time, I will quickly go through the example. Right? So that's a deterministic final automaton that takes binary input, and what it tries to make sure is that the input contains an even number of zeros. So you have basically the different states that you're modeling, so even number of zeros or odd number of zeros. You have your inputs, one or zero. You have your start state, different zeros, let's say. You have your final state, and then you have the set of transitions, the set of functions that describe the transitions between the states. So this table here does that, describes this function, this transition. So it says basically that if you're at state one and you get a zero, you get to state two. So if you have even zeros and you get a zero, you get to the state of zero. That's a very simple DFA. So what we're thinking is that this is a very good way to model the heap, because then your metadata corruptions are corruptions of this transition function. Right? So you roll, so basically you corrupt, let's say, the S2 here, you make an S to an S1. So even if it is an even zero, and you get a zero as an input, it goes to an even zero. So basically you have broken the internal transition states. And now the data-specific attacks are corruption of the input symbols. So before the allocator actually processes the inputs, you change the zero to a one, let's say. You have corrupted the input data to the allocator. So I think this is a great way to represent allocators. It's not realistic to actually sit down, pen and paper, understand the allocator, and make the DFA. So what we have done is we've written a binary instrumentation field tool that tries to construct the DFA based on the observed data, metadata transition, like that. Of course, you will think that this does not provide a representative model of the allocator, because you cannot feed the application all possible data to map all possible states. So then you need to find to manually function the model. And the trap is still here, right? So if you have done that, then if you have manually functioned it, does it really represent the allocator that was supposed to represent the first place? Yeah, maybe at some a certain level, but you're not sure if it's a real representation. But that's actually a way to start thinking about automating this code. And as I said, this is a working progress, actually. Okay, I'm out of time. I don't know if you have like one or two questions.
One.
That's one. Okay, let's not take it for time. If you have any questions, or if you have to ask them, just catch me offline.
Thank you.